Well, hello, good morning. Thanks for waking up so early. Today I'm going to speak about what you shouldn't do when you are trying to do Hadoop. Do Hadoop, code Hadoop. But some of these mistakes are always extensible to any kind of development, human life, you know. So, first of all, hi. Engineer at Shifted. I have been big data team lead at GFT. I worked with research and development in the Magister and other domain stuff, like 8 years. And some of my main skills are Hadoop, search engines, Agile, Java, software engineering. Yeah. And those are my two little years with couple of hours of life. So, mistakes. We arrive in a nest, Seneca said, we need a little hope. Everybody commits mistakes. Making mistakes, making errors, making things the wrong way is normal and is usual. So, we have to live with that. Okay. And as other people say, one who makes no mistakes makes nothing. Like, we have to learn from failure, not from success. Or we learn more from failure than from success. Mistakes are proof that you are trying. If you don't commit mistakes, it's because you are not doing anything different. You're doing always, you're safe, bubble. So you have to go out of it. But the important thing is, if you are repeating mistakes again and again and again, and you don't learn anything, that's worth nothing. Those are the really dangerous mistakes. You have to learn from them and try to avoid them and repeat them just twice. You can't repeat the same mistake twice, but not three times is too much. So please, make mistakes, but not so many times. So when you are developing I don't like the term, a big data application, what could possibly go wrong? When you're developing one app, what could possibly go wrong? When you're trying to scale it live or to production or to 1,000 machines, 100 machines, 10 machines, well, everything. So be prepared. Be prepared for the failure. Okay? And which kind of these failures can you commit? Well, first, you have to know what you are doing. Sometimes you are trying, in our business, we have to try new technologies, we try to read a blog, whatever, manual, the docs, we start developing things. We think, okay, this is correct, this is working fine. Let's put it in production, let's scale it up for 5 machines, 10 machines, for a cluster, whatever. Well, you have to know a little bit how it works before doing that. Or you can find some strange and weird behavior. Then the second one is that moment before coffee, like now. When you are doing things, you have to be aware of what you are doing, you have to be inspired, you have to be awake, you have to be conscious of what you are doing. Because if you are like now, like, okay, 9 in the morning, what I'm doing, I will pick just the first track and go there. That's one example, maybe I'm not angry. But we have to be aware, we have to be conscious of what we are doing. That brilliant idea is like, okay, I'm going to make a revolutionary app, think twice or three times. Then there are other market, team, boss, management pressures, like, we don't have time for that. Skip that part, it's not necessary. Well, make a balance before skipping things. And not thinking about the future, like, okay, but this is going to work now, and what before putting something in production, it's like, okay, we have suddenly a lot of exit and we have 10 times, 1,000 times the traffic, the people, the users we thought what is going to happen. So this translated to we are new technology require time to learn and time to configure properly, especially if you are working with clusters, communication between machines, IPs, nets, files, and very new technologies that don't have, like, you don't know. To configure a MySQL database is very easy because you have a lot of the workbench, you have PHP MyAdmin with these beautiful consoles to create users, delete users. When you are working on things new as Hadoop, like 4 years ago, you don't have an interface. So you have to learn how the guts of Hadoop work sometimes. That's not easy. That's not easy for new systems, that's not easy for old, very old systems. So the other thing is, like, for us, for each one of us in this room, we are the best developers in our teams. So our own mistakes are not mistakes, are like features. Like, we discuss them fast with like features. So we have to ask feedbacks a lot of time. We have to check what we are doing, check what our colleagues are doing, and ask feedback and say, okay, you think this is going to, can you give a try to look at this code and this architecture that I have designed and see if something is doesn't sound good for you, this, and do it. Do it. I speak a lot at work. My colleagues are annoyed with me, so do it. I know your colleagues. Then that's the only, the last two ones are the difficult ones to apply in the map. Don't sacrifice critical features before real life. That's very easy to say, but what's a critical feature? That's the difficult part here. Like, okay, for me, one critical feature always will be the backup or the recovery. If you, and especially if you are working with data and with big data and with clusters and with Hadoop, if you are going to do something with a lot of data, you are not very sure of it, and you may lose the system, you have to be in an ecosystem in a way that you can recover from that and fail fast and recover even faster. Doing an MVP or POC previous to a gigantic app is common sense thing. If you think something is going to try, if it doesn't, for, in big data especially, if it doesn't work for 100 lines, it won't work for 100 million lines. So let's try. And it is, for us, it's very, very easy to make some mockups and try things. And then reuse this code and try to scale it up, fix it, improve it, refactor it, whatever you need. So error number one. Most of these are real errors. But just with these guys, I would not do because I can't reveal you private information of the companies they have worked. But configuration issues. The symptom was that the misconfiguration led to data duplication and crazy behaviors. Like, we have less pages than dividing the number of resumes by the paginate, by the page size. So we have 1 million results, page size was 10, we started paginating on the results. Normally it would be like 100,000 pages. No, it was like 10,000. Very weird. Why? Because we have the incorrect configuration on the shards on Solar Cloud. So a demo of what is, this is the result of a Solar search in JSON. So we have the response with some general data that is like, how many documents are there? Where are you starting? Like the first result, the last result of this, and then the documents. So, next. So, in the first page, you have like a lot of them. In the second page, 20 results after it, you're expecting to have 20 results less. But you have like 80, 70, something like that. And in the base, like, I don't know, like 100, 1,000, you're expecting to have, well, 100, 20, 20,000. But no. So if that each page you went, if you calculated how many pages you have less. That was like, why? It was very, very difficult to find it. Until we get to this. We have this kind of, you have to configure like that. So cloud was in the past, because I think it has changed quite a lot. And we have this kind of paths for the charts. So all the charts were on the same folder. Each one in its machine. But you have replication. So the first chart is the first machine, and in the first machine, the second chart is in the first and second replicas. Those are supposed to be different files. But if the path is the same, the files are the same, and when you look for a result, you find like in the starting one, you have the result of the start one and the start two. The start two, you have start two and start three. So you have repeated documents. And like the replication was three, it wasn't like the double, and so on, it's like triple, this kind of things. So when MapSolar is very intelligent, and when it finds that you have paginated over one document, it removes all the appendices of this document for the next results. So that's why if you find one, you remove three. If you find 20, you remove 60. So that's why. And that's very easy now. But it wasn't when you were trying to debug this. So another error related with this with configuration. We have like this machine to run all the jobs on the cluster. But we didn't run them on the cluster. So we connected remotely with a command line client to say, okay, you have to run this MapReduce job. An UC job. Run this UC job. And you know what to do. Now we have all the other things like, okay, you have a cluster, you have tracker. Please run this backup. Normal thing is that the job tracker, it creates a job in the job tracker in a cluster, and the job tracker will do the splitting of the files and copying and this TCP and this kind of things in a cluster. But installing a new version, someone installed YAML inside. So when you talk to this machine to launch a command on the job tracker, he says, okay, but the job tracker is not on the cluster anymore. I am the job tracker. So one single machine tried to do something that 36 machines needed to do. So you imagine the logs, you imagine the time they spent, like 3 days to do a backup of two gigas. Why? Because you have to go, decode documents on the HDFS, bring them here, copy to the other cluster. So that's something very simple, is installing a new command line tool. And in fact, because of some specific XML where you have to say, okay, the job tracker address is not localhost, is this one, and that was missing a simple XML file with three lines. Suddenly your 1.5 hour backup job last 2 days. So the daily backup is not daily anymore. Okay. So another real example. Block file, for a file that has like n blocks, like it's very big, it's split, it's sharded in different, in HDFS, in different machines. Anyway, you trade it, it was like, you use it one number. You configure like, okay, I zero mappers, minus one mappers.
I think it was just only one. It's like, why? And then
we realized that file was missing the set. So it's like, if you know how it works, it's like you have to read the full file to decrypt it and compress it. So it's normal. It was doing the normal thing. If I have a file that is unique, it doesn't matter if it's in 30 machines, but it's unique file, and you try to read it in 10 different sequences, in parallel, in 10 with 10 machines, it won't work. You need to read it, full of it, to have it. So, take away here, first, take coffee. Ask for feedback because it was an error because one person was going to try to do this. And the moment she shared it, the moment three persons look at it, they say, okay, oh fuck, this is a file, you have to compress it and prepare it for HDFS. So that's the takeaway here. You have to prepare your files for HDFS. But it works in normal file processing like reading logs. It doesn't work in Hadoop. In fact, you have your own compression in Hadoop, let's see how others use it, because it's like you have zip files that are not zip files, and you don't have to compress, and you don't have to do things well. It does for you. So there are a lot of tools, protocols that actually store the files and zip, compress. Okay. And you should know. And other things, you should know the effect of a path. If you change one path, like the mapper number from 1 to 2, you don't get two mappers, something is not correct. Not in the pattern, but in the way you are doing things. Maybe it's because the file is too small, so it doesn't need it, but if you check and you see, okay, it has like four blocks, so it should be written with four mappers. Not more, but they still have one. There's something else. Okay. And again, that was obvious. Probably anyone seeing this would say, okay, this is a zip file, you can't do it like that. But if it's your first time in Hadoop, it's your first time you read the theory, like, okay, you want one file, split it in blocks, you can use several. It's not so obvious. That's one of my problems. Someone refactor code, make it more beautiful, make it more beautiful, easy to manage, let's say, better code. And suddenly a process that had to take 5 minutes takes 15. It's not so much for a daily batch. But okay, it's 3 times it. And it should be faster because we have made a refactor. So. And reviewing the logs, we found a line repeated millions of times. So what was the problem? That someone added a simple log traces on a method. So again, forget about Hadoop for a moment and say this is a Java method. That for arrow, for some document, it calculates the net amount based on the gross amount that it already has. It supposes that it always has to. But the value, look for null pointers, this is pseudocode. And then, okay, let's see what we are doing. Let's see if this is correct so we can check if something fails, because calculating the tax is very, very important feature, so we need to track it and have it clear that we are doing it the wrong way, the good way. But good intentions, well, coding doesn't mean always doing good. So you see these kind of blocks, very useful, but, and this is not even 1/10 of the real block. 40 million lines. And there were two blocks. I'm starting the method, I'm ending the method. So, 15 minutes of processing for 40 meters is not very much if you are writing all of these logs. I left the company before seeing the logs moved. But I guess it will be like 4 minutes, 5 minutes, because maybe less. So what you see, this beautiful statue, says everything. Okay, another one of my preferred mistakes, and this is the asshole. Think about model changes. If I'm not attending here, I do things with data, so I have one model here, and I define the models, that's part of my job. I say, okay, a person will have a NIF, a DNA, some national document, a photo maybe, it may have, like, I don't know, the gender, the weight, this kind of stuff. You say, okay, it would be nice to have the birth date. But we didn't have it yesterday. So think, prepare what you are doing for this kind of changes, because you will find this kind of changes if you're dealing with data. So what was this specific error? Okay, so someone say, okay, I want to refactor the code because the name, the order of the attributes of the params is like mixed. It's like I have my name, my surname, and I will add my alias. But I will put just after the surname because it's like related. Before the address, before the birthday, not in the end, like, no, because just to have it on there. Okay? So, okay. The refactor this code into this code. Any difference? You see something bad in this code? In this code. That was working fine. That was supposed to be working fine. That arrived until staging, until the last very part of the deployment to production. In this company, we deploy to production every 3 months or 4 months. So deploying, yeah, it's happening. Okay. So then we said, okay, we have to do a regression test. And we did, and it failed. It failed very bad. Well, what happens in today you write something with this method, and tomorrow you try to read it with this method. It will arrive a point when it will break, because the name that you wrote yesterday is not a Boolean. It's obvious now. It wasn't obvious then. So, how do you solve this? Okay, you can say, okay, if current date is Saturday 27th of, or previous to 27th, let's write with this method and have a, like, this method will be a little bit old and a little bit new. No, let's make a process to update, read and write again all the files, so we update the how we do. No, don't do that. Or you can say, okay, let's make the first field will be a person field. So if the person is one, use the method one, and it will have like different classes with the persons. Well, you can try that, but I don't see it. Or you can create your own protocol for serialization. Like, okay, I will create my own exceptions and interceptions. I will try to get the other field because I think it's not enough. Or try to get everything like charged and then try to cast, and if it doesn't cast, don't try it. My recommendation is use Abra or something similar, because it solves your order, your new attributes, removing attributes, removing things. But, and you have a link here, this will be shared, so you can click on it, where it explains why using Abra and Drift and these kind of things really works well, instead of trying to do your own Abra. Another advantage of Abra is like, if you want to write it in HTTPS and you are going to read it with, I don't know why, PHP, you can do it. Like, you don't need to copy all the reader Java class and try to make a library with it or whatever, a service or not. You can do it. You can see it as a JSON if you think with the schema inside. Okay. Next thing. and we are starting the theoretical errors. So these are not yet so concrete. Big data everywhere. Everything is big data in the world now. So bootstrapping an app takes more time than executing it. If you have seen some MapReduce jobs, you see like the init, the processing, and the ending. What in fact is MapReduce is map, sort and support, reduce. And in map you have init, terminate, sort and support is in the background, init, terminate. So for doing some things, like counting how many lines you do a map file, you will see like, okay, you have half minute depending on the size of the cluster, depending on the kind of patterns that you have, the configuration, half minute of processing, 10 seconds of counting lines, and half minute, 15 seconds of closing it. So it's okay, you need 1 minute to do a 10 seconds thing. In fact, I have said counting lines. How do you count lines in a file? One command, or counting minus L, files, milliseconds. So how do you call big data? How can you call something big data? How can you call big data to 1 terabyte when this is 50 euros in El Corte Inglés or in the market? 50 euros. This is not big data. So what it can be. So don't call big data. Don't try to do map reduce things. Don't try to do Hadoop things for things that don't need it. Please. That's my advice. So, next one. And again, those are more theories. We do you things from scratch. You did something, it's working well on MapReduce, it's working fine on Hadoop. And now they say, okay, now this is not going to be a batch job. End of day of each 24 hours, it will be one batch of each hour. So product owner is like, okay, we need to have like more real time, let's say 1 hour. And you say, okay, have to redo everything here, I have to change this part, change this module, change of the cross, configuration, and dependencies, transformations to prepare data, have to redo it everything from scratch, and I have to, I don't know, leave out MapReduce and start doing streaming with Kafka and Flow and whatever. Okay, when you are designing something, if you have to do this, if you have to redo everything, to reuse and redo, the business logic inside, you are not doing things well, guys. So you should be doing things like clean code, solid principles, read the software, read the software craftsmanship book, or see the software craftsmanship chapter. You should take a look at the delta architecture if you are going to design something like big data and microservices, just to be closer with the next, the last chapter. In Hadoop doesn't mean doing all the code in a map method or in a reduce method. Please, let's avoid. And then the last theoretical one. The inability to move forward due to dependencies and technical debt. What I mean, you have like, I don't know, annotations everywhere, and you have to do a new feature and you have to invent and reinvent and configure whatever, lots of annotations in your code, even though you don't need them now. No? And the problem normally is that you added this very useful functionality, very practical that you're going to use every day and you haven't yet used in a year. So if you add something in your code, it will be a takeaway. If you add something in your code, it has to be used. If it's not used, I won't see the world up, you know. So for these things, it's like, it's more complicated to know when to add things. The good ideas are not always good ideas, but you have to be conscious of what you did is not working well, it's not good anymore. So take it away, throw it away, remove it. You have to be prepared to throw away all the technology you do if it doesn't work. You can be like, okay, no, my legacy application is the best one. It has been with me for 15 years, so I will maintain this COBOL code. I was going to C-sharp, so some kind of advice here. Think on the use you are going to do to your app. If it's going to be like the make the world a better place by parsing the Apache logs, why? Why? It's because you have to give feedback to something, you have to do analytics, you have to make something with these logs for the data insight, for the data scientist, for the data analyst. You have to do reporting with traffic or clicks or revenue. So think on the use you are going to do to the app and make things for this use. If you are going to make another use, try to separate, fragment, create another microservice using part of this app or whatever to use the data in the proper way. So if you are doing something for getting logs with clicks, a click stream, your application does a click stream. If you want to query this with Hive, don't put modules on Hive and Hive decompressions there. Put the data in a common place and create another app to read there. With Hive, with Pentos, whatever. Okay. So think on the use you are going to do with data. And I will end soon because I want you to ask questions to me if you want. And I will say, okay, takeaway number one, advice, global advice number one. Forget about Hadoop when you are developing Hadoop. Okay, why? You have to keep your business logic separately, completely from the framework. You have to be framework agnostic as much as possible. So you can change the framework if it doesn't work for you. If you have, we are speaking Java, we have a lot of packages, and we have like a business package, let's say, with all the logic, with all the models, whatever. And then we need to change this from Hadoop to Spark, so we don't have a MapReduce anymore. If we have separated packages for the model, let's say you can use it in Hadoop application, in the its own package, or in the Spark application, in its own package. Even more, if you have it in a separated JAR file, you could use like this, like a library. Like, if you have it in another service with whatever, you can use it like a service to read whatever. So forget all these things. With Hadoop, I don't recommend using a lot of service because of the latency. So you can use libraries. Okay? And takeaway number two. Keep Hadoop in mind. So forget about it. When you are developing the business logic, when you are developing the model, when you are developing things, but keep in mind that the line of code, the program, the thing you are going to execute, to run, is going to run millions and millions of times. So if you put a log file, make sure to put it switchable. Like, okay, I want a log file for development. If I go live to production, I don't want to see the logs. If I want real logs, I will use a distributed log system because logs in an app and logs in a distributed apps works in a different way. If you have a web, a modern web, that you develop it, you won't be using probably anymore logs with the data rolling and in a Unix machine, or everything in one Unix machine, and then copying it to HFS or whatever. You will use something like login or logly or this kind of tools. Distributed login from different apps in the same way. So that's the idea. If you want distributed apps, use distributed tools, use distributed configuration. And when you are writing, you say, okay, this is going to have to be fast. It has to be fast. So develop it like me with a framework or with the proper plan. Okay? So, fast questions, but before the questions, I will put this slide here, like company slide. So, please, any questions? Any advice? Any error to share? Manu, you share. No? No feedback? Thanks.